Once upon a time, a six-year-old boy jumped out of a second floor window holding an umbrella, thinking that that would cushion his fall. The umbrella broke. He didn't suffer any major injuries. He landed, but that was part of his youth. And this boy went on to surmount many challenges in his life. In this particular case, it was a challenge against a higher power, gravity. Welcome to the life of Alfred Avellana, Xerez-Burgos Jr. My name is Kirito Henson.
And I'm Menchu Henato, but a Xerez-Burgos, of course, Henson.
The story of Freddie's life wouldn't be complete without acknowledging the family's patriotic history. His father, Alfred Aelia Xerez-Burgos Sr., left a legacy of patriotism and service, no doubt passed on by their lineage of patriotic forebearers, whose virtues built a foundation for the future Xerez-Burgos generations. One of these patriots was Dr. Manuel Xerez-Burgos, a philanthropist who sponsored the education of our national hero, Jose P. Rizal, in Ateneo de Manila. Dr. Manuel was the only child of Antonia Garcia Burgos and Manuel Xerez, a Spanish merchant. His mother, Antonia, was the daughter of Tiburcio Burgos, a Spanish lieutenant, and Florencia Garcia, an Ilocana mestiza. Antonia's brother was Father Jose Burgos y Garcia, the renowned martyred priest and one of the prominent heroes of our country. The deaths of Father Burgos and the two other martyrs, Fathers Gomez and Zamora, sparked the Cavite Mutiny and inspired Dr. Jose P. Rizal's Noli Me Tangere and El Filibusterismo. The Burgos' ancestral home in Vigan, Ilocos Sur, has been preserved and is currently a museum for tourists. It was Father Jose Burgos himself who insisted on preserving the Burgos family name. According to Spanish customs at that time, wives were allowed to carry on their maiden surname down the line, hence the surname Xerez-Burgos instead of the usual Xerez y Burgos.
Having such a rich and noteworthy family history and legacy wasn't easy for Freddie. Actually, it became a heavy weight that he had to carry on his shoulders. His dad was a disciplinarian, and during the summer vacation in 1965, he was sent on a boat headed for Japan to work in the boiler room. Every summer, his dad made it a point to keep him busy. It was tough for Freddie to grow up with his three sisters, Bibay, Bilit, and Tess, with the pressure of being the only boy to continue the family's legacy.
Freddie was a very well-behaved boy, although sometimes he would get himself into little brawls. One afternoon, Sofronio had to go looking for him and found him in the basketball court, all bruised and with broken glasses. So brought him home, and my mother wondered, what happened? Did you get into a fight again? Yes, ma'am. What happened? He was so upset, and they picked a fight on the boys who called him Mistisong Bangos. And that was what he hated to be called. And my mother started laughing, put him in front of the mirror and said, Iho, mukhang tama sila, mukhang Mistisong Bangos ka talaga. He was so upset and really, really cried.
Freddie as a young boy was not spoiled. Even if he was the only son, he would be very responsible and take care of each and every one of us. The difference between Tess and I was 5.5 years, so I remember very vividly when Mommy went to the hospital to give birth to Tess. He kept on prodding Papi and told him, Papi, return the baby inside. I don't want a girl. I want a boy. But that's why Tess was very, very close to him. Now, one time I remember we went to see a bullfight. I think there were some people that came in from Spain, and so they had these bulls and everything. So we watched that fight. And where we were living in Little Baguio, there were a herd of carabaos that were walking down the street. And he thought that they were bulls, so he started running and going through our fence, and our fence was barbed wire, so he whacked his butt. And I remember, instead of bringing him to the hospital, mommy, being a nurse, was the one who stitched his butt.
Speaking of our growing up years, I was really in awe, as I never saw you whacked by Poppy or mommy. I remember, though, how you tricked me into standing behind your bike as you maneuvered downhill in front of our house. Of course, you told me we should just imitate the circus act on TV, and we ended up tumbling down the asphalted road on General Gutierrez. Mind you, I still have a big scar to prove it. Mommy, of course, thought you could do no wrong, and always promoted you to higher positions in Ayala Corporation, even while you were a junior executive.
Freddie grew up in a middle-class community in the city of San Juan, where he commuted daily to and from the LSU since his fourth grade. In school, he was surrounded by kids from powerful and affluent families, and some of them became his closest friends.
In grade school, I remember very well that in La Salle, there were a lot of acacia trees. And so one of the favorite games during recess was acacia seed wars. And during one of these recesses, Eddie Gaspar threw you an acacia fruit, and it unfortunately hit your eye, and you were quite seriously affected. So Eddie Gaspar later on was telling us that he was really, really afraid. Of course, we were kids at that time, and he learned that your father was with the military, and so he was afraid that he was going to be arrested. What is remarkable is that your dad, and I think a lot of people will not understand this reaction at this time, he actually went to the house of Eddie to speak to the parents and to speak to Eddie as well, to assure him and assure them that this was all an accident and there was nothing to be concerned about. Now that is certainly an action that speaks of the class of your dad, and this has definitely rubbed off on you.
Some of my thoughts about Freddie. In the lower grades, we were classmates 1 year. I remember because my mom would call your mom to get the homework whenever I was sick and I hadn't gone to school. Then through the next years, we would see each other in school, but that was about it. And in college, we became very good friends because we were classmates, and we would study together, you, Eloy Valles, Rafi Esteban, myself, in my house. And after 10 minutes of studying, you'd stand up, use the phone. I don't know who you were talking to. I assume it was Tina, but Tina, I'm not sure. I never interrupt, so I'm really not sure. You better ask him. Then we'd have a break. We had just started, but we'd have a break. We'd look for some dessert, some cake that there always was at home, or at least ice cream. After that, we'd study half an hour, and then another break. This time it was for coffee. And we'd prepare the coffee. You remember, Freddie, we'd mix it, till I'd become whitish. So that would take a long time. We'd take the coffee while we chatted, then we'd study again. This went on almost through the whole 5 years of college. Then in school, I recall one time when Rafi and Kaloy were fighting. Every time in the machine shop during the break, you and I were having a soft drink and something to eat. They were fighting. Of course, what else would they fight about but girls? Who's fooling who? And that was the whole thing. And the Chinese classmates would ask us, are they going to get to blows? And we'd say, no, forget it. They're never going to get to blows. No. Then the main thing you did for me in school was being my partner in the thesis, the project study. because we even got medal thanks to you, because, you know, the professor hated me and would have flunked me if he could. You risked it, but we did well. And in the process, we would do some of the project study in your father's office after office hours, or the last few days, it was even during lunch break, your father would allow us to use it. And his secretary would stay with us sometimes to do the typing. There was a machine downstairs, which people nowadays won't realize how special it was to us, where it would make the coffee black with sugar or with cream and sugar. And we loved that machine. We kept on going down and buying coffee, just for the machine, not for the coffee. But, you know, all through that time, we never offered that poor secretary one cup of coffee. How we did that, I don't know, because we would have stood up thoughts of it. But anyway, we were young. But the main thing you did for me in school that I'll never forget is in that mechanical drawing, the fifth floor, the last classroom, we were doing something, you submitted it. You come to me and you say, let's go to the canteen. And I said, I'm just going to write my name and then we go. You say, I'll write your name, you pack up. So, okay, you write my name, I'm packing up my things. And when I'm submitting the paper to the professor, I see you misspelled my name. How many people will misspell their own names? I was so mad at you. You had to come with me, you explained it to the professor, he accepted the explanation, thank goodness.
He came from simple and humble beginnings and remembered well his dad's words. The best gift I could give you is your education, not riches. And what you do from here on is entirely up to you. And Freddie didn't disappoint. He was active and diligent in school, a consistent honor student, the captain of the football team, a member of the volleyball team, and even a member of the cheerleading squad.
On our football days, we played a lot of football in grade school, high school, and college. And it was always time for victories. But at the end of our college era, I found myself with the Ateneo and playing against you in La Salle. And it was a very fortunate time for us in the Ateneo because La Salle had the poorest team in the recent years. La Salle always had a good team, but this time there were very few good players, and the only ones who were with La Salle that were good were Rafi Esteban and yourself. And in any case, we ended up winning against you and winning the NCAA championship. And again, the class that your dad showed when you were young certainly rubbed off on you because you were a most generous loser. I mean, usually people who lost were bad sports, but you took it in stride and you recognized the fact that it was our turn to win.
He also earned the spot of second highest ranking officer in the Reserve Officers Training Corps, or ROTC. His mother, Pepita, instilled in him Catholic values of simplicity, humility, charity, and piety, among others, which explains why Freddie is known to be as frugal as he is, staying away from material pursuits while continuing to serve in church as a lay minister to this day and praying the rosary daily. Family time was sacred as they gathered every Sunday where Pepita would cook up a hearty lunch for everyone.
I have many memories of Freddie, but what stands out was an incident during our second year high school. It was a Friday and we were out on a field trip for a biology class. We were supposed to visit some laboratories, and during a lunch break somewhere along Ross Boulevard, while the others brought out their baons, Freddie, Ricky Smile, Joel Acambra, and I decided to leave the group and eat our favorite pork barbecue at the Aristocrat. We lost track of the time, so when we returned to rejoin the rest, the bus had already left. In all fairness, we tried looking for the bus, but After a while and no success, we decided instead to watch a movie. I remember it was Light in the Piazza, starring Yvette Mimieux. The following Monday, when we entered the classroom, we were met by a stern-looking Brother Leon, our biology and home teacher, who advised us that we were suspended and could not return until the principal, then Brother Benedict, saw our dads. To make a long story short, it helped that our dads all knew Brother Ben, so the individual meetings turned out well. In fact, our transgressions were hardly touched on. But we were nonetheless required as punishment to do manual labor and spent almost a whole Saturday scrubbing and cleaning the walls outside the classrooms at the second floor of the main DLSU building in Taft. We did a pretty good job, so it would pain us every time we would see students leaning against the wall with one foot up against it later on.
Tina likes to tell this story about how she met Freddie Xerez-Burgos at a school activity in the Ateneo campus, an activity called the SCA, or Student Catholic Action, on January 26, 1964. They were all in fourth year high school. Each Catholic school of Metro Manila sent several representatives, approximately 10 to 20 each, so that the area was bustling with young high school teens, all assigned to different cell groups for topic discussions. Schoolmates were allowed to pair off with preferred friends, so naturally, Tina went to an assigned classroom with close friend Amelia Perfecto Tirona.
Freddie was accompanied by his close friend Toto Revilla, and introductions were exchanged. But, as it happened, no bells rang. Listen. 2 weeks after was the graduation party on February 8, 1964, held at the Sky Room. The strategy of our party was each graduate would invite three boys, not necessarily a boyfriend. It could be someone else's point of interest, para hindi obvious, and no one would be a wallflower, the ratio being 3:1. Amelia had invited Freddie pala. Tina did not know. She had invited some Ateneans that night. Freddie danced with her twice, thrice. Did her heart flutter? Maybe a bit. Siyempre naman, because he was so good looking. But she was not going to raise her hopes.
Going back to the aftermath of their graduation party, naturally, they all had exciting stories to tell. According to Amelia, Freddie had asked for Tina's number. Aha! Or so she thought. She waited and waited. No calls from Freddie. But they were partying almost every weekend and would see each other occasionally. One lazy April afternoon, Tina's friend, Isabel Quirola Golamco, was at Tina's house. They were talking about parties, proms, who was going out with whom, and Tina suddenly said, "Ano kaya? The doorbell will ring and Freddie Burgos will come a-knocking." Guess what? 30 minutes later, the maid enters Tina's room and announces that Freddie Burgos and Toto Revilla were at the sala, wanting to see Tina. How's that for witchcraft? And Tina says, "Just go and ask Isabel. She will attest to all of this." But, according to Freddie, he had only passed by to drop certain photos of a recent party that Tina had attended. That's Freddie. He would never admit that he came to see Tina. This started his occasional phone calls and initial dates.
I think this is in our college years. You had a car. I didn't have a car at that time. And I used to hitch a ride home with you. And there was many a time that instead of going straight home, we would pass by Tina's house. And you would spend time with her. We would have a chat with her. I would be in the middle of the conversation, chat with her mom, her auntie. And after a while, it occurred to me that maybe in those times, you had wanted to be alone with Tina. Yet, you never refused me a ride home. And only later on did it occur to me that you were so generous in that sense that you didn't care that I inconvenienced your courting visits. You know, and that Tina was so gracious and that she never objected and you never made me feel as if, what's this fly doing in the ointment?
When we would go out to parties, Tina would bring her maid as a chaperone and my wife would bring her maid as a chaperone. And so in one party, Freddie said, why don't you bring your wife's maid to my car so that she and my maid can stay together and not get bored the whole night? Oh, that's a good idea, I said. Okay, so we did that. And in the party, finally Freddie said, Ed, we can go away and go somewhere else. This party is a bore. Let's go somewhere else. Let's use your car, the four of us, so we can have each other without chaperones. Oh my goodness, Freddie, that's a good idea. So that was the naughty Freddie. You know, he has his ways of planning things out so we can all enjoy the unchaperoned date that we both have.
Isang araw, nagpunta ako sa mama to visit her in 9th Street. And when I arrived, galit ang mama. Naku, umuusok ang tenga, sabi sa akin. Alam mo, King, sabi niya, yung si Freddie, makikita niyan sa akin. Wow, Freddie, galit na galit sa'yo. So sabi ko, ma, anong ginawa ni Freddie? Galit na galit ka sa kanya. Dinala ko dun sa sala. Tinuro sa akin yung sapa. Nakikita mo ba yan? Sabi niya, lundong-lundo na yung sapa kong yan. Well, parati dyan na uupo yung lumiligaw kay Tina. So pagsasabihin ko yan, doon naman siya sa kabilang dulo ng sapa mo po. Ay, naku, palagay ko. Kaya ganun ang mama, yun lang ang nakikitang fault sa'yo bilang future son-in-law.
They married on November 10, 1969. Don't take my love lightly. And had four children, Albi, Joby, Carlo, and Anna. Loving me. Oh, when I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord your love I'll keep. If I should die before I wake, I'll come back for you. That's no mistake. Oh, can't forget you ever. Our love was meant to be.
Tina graduated with a degree in accounting, married Freddie in 1969, and worked at the Philippine National Bank. She was actually the family's breadwinner while Freddie was pursuing his master's degree in business management at the Asian Institute of Management. Freddie eventually graduated from AIM with distinction and won a gold medal for his thesis before taking a job at SC Johnson. After a five-month stint, he transferred to Ayala Corporation and worked under its real estate division. He worked up the ranks until he became vice president. In Ayala Corporation, he was put in charge and became president of notable projects such as Makati Sports Club, Alabang Country Club, Ayala Alabang Village, Ayala Center's Greenbelt and Glorieta, and Ayala Property Management Incorporated. Despite the numerous achievements, Freddie wasn't happy in his 20-year career in Ayala Corporation. He felt that office politics and rigid layering of large corporations stifled individual growth and fulfillment. Before going on his own, he gave it one final try and worked for Robinson's Land under John Gokongwei, where he helped John Gokongwei build Robinson's Galleria in Ortigas Center.
Freddie had a very close and affluent friend from his DLSU days, Gerardo Jerry Ortigas Lanusa, who kept him close for opportunistic projects.
Then after we graduated, We continued seeing each other, have breakfast or things like that. And then we decided to do something together, which was to go into construction. The two of us with Vito Santos, and Billit was also with us. Then we did a few projects here and there, and then I said, okay, let's do my house. Frankly speaking, I never trusted that the house was going to last that long, but it's 30 years and it's still there and it's still okay. So we did a good job. Then when we played some Excel, I wanted you with us because I wanted your experience. You had been in Ayala, you had been Lanco doing all of these things. So I wanted your experience, which helped us a lot in how to save money or where to save money and what to expect. We went through the financial crisis of 2008 and we've been able to finish the buildings. So I thank you for that.
One such project was a consortium called Lagos, an acronym for Gerardo Lanuza, Alfred Xerez-Burgos, and Joselito Santos. Together, they built a very successful Alexandra condominium located in the Ortigas complex back in the 1990s. Later on, in the 2010s, Jerry and Freddie built two more residential condominium projects, the Icon Residences and the Icon Plaza in Bonifacio Global City, or BGC. After Freddie's stint in Robinson's Land, he and a former junior colleague during his Ayala days, Danilo Danny A. Antonio, formed the Land Company, or Landco, in 1990. In retrospect, this was one of the worst times to establish a real estate company in the Philippines. The country was mired by successive coup d'etats instigated by rebel forces against the newly established Corazon Aquino administration, which dampened investor sentiments. Because of this, Freddie and Danny could not raise capital. So with 500,000 pesos in their pockets, they decided to transform Landco into a consultancy firm, focusing on landed individuals who did not have the professional and technical expertise to conceptualize and execute their real estate projects. Suddenly, Landco became a frontrunner in real estate consulting. Yet, Freddie still felt that consultancy had many limitations. He always complained about working so hard to make other people rich, while the partnership would collect insignificant amounts in the form of consultancy fees.
In 1994, Freddie and Danny decided to partner with Metro Pacific Investments, Inc., and renamed the company Landco Pacific Corporation. Around this time, Freddie's sons, Albie and Joby, joined the company. And among the most notable projects were the Canyon Woods Residential Resort in Laurel, Batangas, Peninsula de Punta Fuego, and Terrazas de Punta Fuego in Nasugbu, Batangas, Ponderosa Leisure Farms in Silang, Cavite.
I recall we went to Bicol right after Reming happened. And Bicol was really very devastated. Now, the thing is, there was no electricity and, you know, we stayed in this Alicia Hotel, which only had genset, I think for 6 hours every night, no? But the following day, you were so happy because somehow they found a way to bring halo-halo, no? From Tiwi Albay to Legazpi. There was no electricity in Legazpi, but somehow, no, there was ice and there was halo-halo. That famous halo-halo was all the way there in Legazpi. Freddie loves halo-halo. We all know that. But the thing is, he eats halo-halo in a very peculiar way. It's called halo-halo, right? So you're supposed to mix it. But Freddie never mixes it. He just scoops in and eats it, you know, without mixing anything or without mixing everything, no? And it's one of his oddities that I find so amusing because hindi niya talaga hinahalo yung halo-halo. You're such a great person. I really will have to say that, no? You're such a charismatic and such an endearing boss. You know, we were all always energized by your words and, you know, you could razzle-dazzle anybody. Like in, you know, in Landco, we like to joke that AXB can sell ice to the Eskimos and can probably sell snake oil. you know, things like that. Because you're really such a charmer. But more than your charm, your charisma, and, you know, that down-to-earth attitude, your humility, I really just admire you for being such a God-fearing person.
Freddie retired from LANCO in 2009 and served as its vice chairman of MPIC. Albie, Freddie's oldest son, took over as president and CEO, while Joby, his second-born son, handled all the construction and procurement-related activities. It was during this time that changes in the environment and industry dynamics posed very restrictive challenges. The highly competitive industry, as well as the thinning out of the high-end market segment, required LANCO to shore up its capital structure. Albie decided to hand over the reins of LANCO to MPIC to give it a soft landing. By doing this, Alexi could then concentrate on businesses where it could thrive and excel, particularly with Forest Lake Development Inc., or FLDI, a memorial park development business. The family fully acquired FLDI with five operating memorial parks from LANCO in 2010.
From the beginning, from the start of Forest Lake, makasama na kami ni Freddie. And he's, I would say, very fair, very supportive, pero matindi. He really works hard. He really puts everything in there. Once he forms an opinion, he will support it strongly. Ang hirap kontra him, therefore he believes in his point. Now, if you think you have an opposing opinion, you present it little by little. Once he sees it, he will change his tone and listen. He listens and even follows. He appreciates that, but you know it's very hard. Pag pumasok siya ng very strong arrive niya, mahirap kontrahin yan, di ba? So, because he's the sole owner, how do you argue against that, di ba? But it's my job, if I think, our job, I think if we are in the right, or we think we have to present our case, you know, so that he could see the opposite point of view, di ba? That's our obligation to Freddie. Otherwise, he has good business sense. Even if we follow his view, it always ends up with the profit. We never cheat on taxes. We minimize, of course, what business is that. But we never cross the line of foul play. No, we don't do that. We are upright businessmen and proud to be working for Forest Lake. This is a company that is paying its dues through hard work, succeeding because of good fundamentals and good business plan and dedicated in development, delivering on our promises. It's a good company. That is because of Freddie behind. Okay? It's Freddie's culture.
Sa trabaho naman, what can I say? You know, when you are known to hold long meetings, because you debate, you love to reason out every detail of a business transaction. You know, huh? And at the end of all the arguments, when all the ideas have been given in, you will simply say, "But this, I am firm on this. I will not force you to do it, but you will all obey." Yun. Ganyan ang mga aliman eh. I will not force you, but you will obey.
From the moment that Albie and Joby retired from LANCO, the family redirected the investable funds of Alexi towards FLDI to capitalize on the opportunities presented by infrastructure and economic growth in the countryside. In the meantime, Carlo, Freddie's youngest son, had been busy with acquiring new sites to grow the business into 32 operating memorial parks by 2019, making it the leading memorial park development company in the country in terms of sales and number of branches. Alexi Corporation, the family's holding company, has over 70 residential and commercial property rentals today.
While Freddie has been successful in business, he leads a parallel life of service. He's active in the Philippine National Red Cross Rizal Chapter,
Defenders of Bataan and Corregidor, and the Corregidor Foundation.
He also serves as lay minister in St. James the Great and St. Jerome parishes and sits as a member of the Board of Trustees in De La Salle, Cavite.
What can I say except that, you know, if I had the authority to canonize you and Tina, you would have been saints by now. Pero since wala naman akong ganyan authority, I will merely call you Monsignor Freddie from now on. So Monsignor, from now on, I will call you that.
Freddie was once interviewed by one of his grandsons, Juancho. Juancho asked him what the inspiration is behind all his achievements. Freddie answered, "You come into existence with nothing. You may acquire certain material possessions, but in the end, you leave with nothing. Therefore, live your life in preparation for death by remembering that the only things worth living for are the moments of love for others."
What a long way that wide-eyed, umbrella-holding, window-jumping 6-year-old boy has come. But then, nothing has changed. Freddie continues to defy the higher powers, always believing, always dreaming.
Such is the character, personality, and life of Alfred Freddie Avellana Xerez-Burgos Jr.